do want you to mention that as a comment, because one of the things is, even though sometimes people who know to code, how to code a little bit, they'll do this homework and they'll find like it's incredibly tedious, so we might even see some JavaScript sprinkled in there, we just don't want at this point. So even though you're doing it, because it's easier to do it this way, like you write a little multiplier function that takes in everything, multiply by 10, don't do that, we're going to take away points. We accept the design of this program.
Multiply by
20. 20 is still okay. Anything else? Pull this up, and if it takes too much longer, we'll just go ahead and get started. You guys are good?
Yep.
Okay. So for whoever's watching online or is going to watch this later, we have some technical problems, so we're not, you don't see anything on our screen, so you're following along at home on your computer. We're going to start off by going through the homework, and then we'll do it. Once you do the homework, which one of the four it is. So that's just the data set that we're going into class. And what we're going to do with that is we're going to show it in three different ways. Show it as bars, show it as a line, show it as a, sorry, four, right, like a scatter plot. Show bars, a line, area chart, and a scatter plot. The idea is to get comfortable using SVG. SVGs are the crux of a lot of the data visualization that we do. So even though down the road, when you use JavaScript and use D3, you're never going to be manipulating SVG this brute force, this is really an exercise so you kind of see what goes on under the hood. What is the X, the Y, the width, the height, and stuff like that. Okay? So the first exercise is you want to create two bar charts. One of them is going to represent the X dimension and the other one the Y dimension. Well, they'll look different. And even though if there's a typo and you have one bar wrong, we don't take points away, we do want you, you know, and you're typing in one by one, every bar has to be the height of that data point. So we have 10-ish, right? 3, 6, 9, 11. 11 X values, 11 Y values, those are the heights of your bars. Pretty straightforward. Notice that if you don't offset them, it's going to look like you just have one huge bar. If you don't offset your Ys. So you have X, you, this was you create 11 bars, you put all the X's, you put all the heights, and you forget that you need to offset the Y's, because you have all of those and you don't understand why you have 11. This is a really simple mistake that you can make, but this is an example of how to debug things you're going to be debugging later on, is inspecting the element. I'm sorry I don't have this to show you, but who here has ever done that? Have you inspected an element on a web page? So if you right-click and click Inspect Elements, you're going to see the DOM representation and your page, so you can see as you hover over your DOM representation, you'll see that it's always at the same place. So you have all 11 rectangles there, they're just on top of each other. Okay, so you use that to debug things that could happen like that. Okay, the next one is the line charts. And this one is some that people actually lose points for something really straightforward, which is not reading the directions, right? So you are going to create two line charts, and you're going to do them differently. One of them is a line element, one is a path element, okay? And those are done differently. Path element's a little bit more of a hassle because it's that concept of append move from here to here, so you're repeating, and then from here to here, so you repeat that element. So just kind of understanding what a path element is the point of that. And the other one's a line element. Now, of course, as you can imagine from the way that looks, it's not a single line. So you're going to be adding one line element per pair of XYs. So you're going to look different. Make sure you do the two separate ones. Don't do one and do a copy it for the Y like you did for the bars. The bars have the same SVG representation, the lines have different SVG representations.
You said two elements, one is a line element and the other is
a path element. Path element, yeah. Most of the stuff in the homeworks, especially at this point, if you don't remember exactly what it was, a Google it, B, go back to the lectures. There's a lot of examples. And the nice thing I like about the lectures with Alex is that he has those interactive coding things that he does them. So you go back at home and you can play around with that, see, break it, and then go do the homework. It's a nice thing to kind of test out. The next thing is the area chart. So that's very similar, except now it's filled in. I think I asked you to do... so this one I don't specify whether... it's not that I don't specify. When you're doing an area chart, any guesses as to whether we're going to be using lines or paths? How would you... how would you generate an area with a line? Well, you close it, but it wouldn't look like that, right? It wouldn't look like the line in the homework.
What's the difference between that?
What do you mean to do? Lines to kind of go away. So you're going to be, we got a lot of that question, can I use line or path? You can't use line, there's a whole bunch of lines, it's really ugly. So that's why we use a path here, because then you can fill it. Okay?
So how is like polyline?
You know, I haven't used the kind of brute force in such a long time. You can, but just use the in other words, okay. It's perfectly fine. It's just, I'm not great at the homework, so I'm the one who gives all the stuff. And it's just easier if we find, you know, do we, that's not kind of what we taught. I'm sure it would be fine, especially if you said, hey, instead of, like, it's a very aware decision. We don't want, so the thing we don't want people doing is you Google it, you find it, you copy it. And so the moment it's not something we covered, it's not something we talked about, it's beautiful. it's fine. You just want to make a comment that, oh, instead of path, I use polyline because of this or that, or something that shows me that you're aware of your design decision and not, I copied this and then use polyline and it worked.
Okay.
And so the last part of the homework is a scatter plot. A bunch of circles. Remember, circles need an x, a y, and a radius position. And unlike x and y's of other things, it needs a cx. Of course, most people have no documentation, but it's very common that we're so used to using x and y for positions that you use x and y and you don't have any circles. Why not? Because it's cx and cy. I got a question on Slack today, which I thought was worth mentioning. I don't know if whoever wrote it is here. The question of when you scale, everything scales, including the radius. It's just magnifying the whole thing. So if you happen to want your final radius to be something nice too big, just make your initial radius really small, and then when you scale it, it will look bigger, or the size that you want. That is homework one. Really, really straightforward. If you have any questions anyway after this, feel free to post them on Slack, ask me, go to office hours tomorrow. If there are no questions, and so if there are, actually I'm going to do what Alex does, which is, or who was it that said no, Vivek, she learned in class, said when you ask if there are any questions, you wait 30 seconds. Which is really awkward. Yes, there you go, we got one.
So why ask is it
yes. The y-axis, so that's a very good point. Y-axis and SVG starts at the top.
Right.
So because we want it at the bottom, you may want to apply scale.
Right.
Okay. Yes.
So when you use the scale function, right, I noticed that if you do like a negative one, like the position of the jumps, like so if the graph was originally here, if I like do negative one, I would expect
it multiplies all around, but yeah, it pretty much flips, mirrors it on the whatever your x or your y.
Okay, so like, so they'll always be wasted space then.
Why?
Because like if you're.
Because the y originally in SVG, the y zero is up here. We want our y zero to be here, right? So you don't really waste the space, you just move this stuff here, and what was out of the screen. Not out of the screen after, right? Because you go from 0 to 1 and you want it to be 0 to 1. So once you do that minus 1 scale factor, did you try it and push things down?
Well, like, so for like the bar chart, right? I tried it, so it was already all pointing downwards.
Right, that's what the original, that's what the coordinate system of SVG will look like if you just start at 0 and increase the height that way.
Right, and then I flipped it, but then like, so it moved from here to like somewhere up here. And I was like, I wasn't sure what was the best way to like align it so that it doesn't.
Why don't I take a look at your code specifically afterwards?
Okay,
great. Okay, so the last thing we're gonna do is we're gonna look at the exercise. So the page that that's on is if you guys go to databizcourse.net, so just the website for the class. So it's databizcourse.net/2017. Then you go to schedule. You scroll down to week 2, and you click on SVG, and that'll take you to the SVG lecture. If you scroll all the way down to the bottom, there is an exercise. Complete this exercise in JSB, and you click on that. And if you don't mind raising your hand when you're there, or at least some indication, or maybe look up or something that way.
I'm still looking at the link.
So once you get to the SVG lecture, all the way to the bottom. Week two, yeah. No, that SVG. Yeah. So click on week two SVG, all the way to the bottom, click on the exercise. Okay?
How do we submit that one more? Is it just one file?
So that's actually a very good point. So this is, you want to do through Canvas.
Yes.
And right now you're submitting your HTML file. That's it.
Oh, just the HTML.
Just the HTML file.
Not a zip folder?
You can do it with a zip folder. I think it takes just the HTML. Maybe.
You
mentioned zip. It does? Okay, so you zip that one file and you submit that, yes. But as far as content, you don't need anything else. That actually brings me to a very good point. Something that, you know, we all stumble on when we begin is this concept of what is serving up the file. When you double click your HTML file today, homework one, it's beautiful. It populates, it has all of your SVG graphics in there, right? That is because we're not using any JavaScript, we're not running any code. If you, for homework two and forward, double click on any of that HTML, it's going to be blank because you never ran the code. You need something to serve the files and something that is going to run, go through your HTML, find that JS file, run it, it populates your HTML, and then it populates it. So starting number two, when you have all the directions, you're going to be running a little Python server. And so then you're going to have a JS file and an HTML file. So you're going to have two files, and then you're going to zip those and submit those. So that's why when you click on your index.html number two and it's blank, that's fine. Okay, so if everyone's on the tutorial page. Okay, so the tutorial page, the tabs I want you to pay attention to is you see at the top there's HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and then console and output, right? Those are toggles. If you click on it once, it shows up. If you click on it again, it disappears. I'm going to show you because we're going to have a lot of tutorials in this environment, right? Obviously, we haven't covered JavaScript in class yet, so today we're just going to look at HTML, CSS, and output. Now, if you are curious, if you have seen JavaScript before, you're welcome to poke around in JavaScript stuff. It's not what we're going to look at today, okay? So this tutorial is very straightforward, and it's really just to get comfortable again with how HTML and CSS work together. So if we all look at step one, so what we have here on the left is we have a header, a paragraph, and you can see very clearly on the output says SVG introduction, and then you have two SVG rectangles. So the first step, what I want you guys to do is to just make two more and make sure that they're 10 pixels apart so that they're below the current two. Take a minute to do that.
Okay.
have to get.
Oh, no, no, that's why he was, we're going to look at your code and see the number.
Yeah, but what is the name of the beam? Because you are converting the Y.
Oh, this is just like that. So just like the bar, right?
The class. Lecture tomorrow?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, well.
I'll start with the Herbert. I think I'll tell you once the stream starts.
One time. For the X values is Y, and the Y values is.
I'm ready to bring this one.
Okay, so sorry, that was a long time. So what I'm going to do in the future with these is that if we have any more questions, we'll get them towards the end, just so that we can get through the tutorial. I'm assuming nobody had any problems with offsetting those two rectangles, right? If you had changed the Y, they'd be on top of each other, kind of like what could happen with the homework and the bars. Okay, so now we're going to open up the CSS tab, and you'll see that now we have some CSS rules, and we're going to apply those to the rectangles. So if you guys go over to the third, or actually any of the rectangles, but if you go over to pick a rectangle, pick your favorite rectangle, go over to the rectangle definition on the HTML page and add the ID BRCA to that. So you're going to do ID equals BRCA, because boy, R is a rabbit. It's actually in the step three right there. And you're going to add that to the ID of that rectangle, and you're going to see what happens to that rectangle on the right. And anybody who saw what happened?
Pink, color change.
Pink, right? And so the key idea there is it used the CSS rule to become pink. And now this is something people will get caught on. It's a very simple bug. Notice that the BRC has a hashtag in front of it, right? Like a hashtag. That is the ID selector. And it's very important because it's different than the class selector, and sometimes you could have sworn you gave something an ID and you're trying to use a class selector on it. So just remember, the hashtag is the ID. The thing about the ID is there's only one in your page that has that ID. So all of your circles are not going to have an ID, they're going to have a class. But this one rectangle special got an ID, that is the CSS selector for it. The next step is to do the same thing, but instead of an ID, a class. So you can pick a rectangle and add class equals mutex. And you can do that to one or more rectangles, right? Because that's the cool thing about the class. As the name implies, it applies to more than one element. You do that, the CSS rule applies, your rectangle is now ready.
So how do we define class?
Sorry, go ahead. What's the question?
How do we define class like above this this scope?
How you define a class, you mean in the HTML or in the CSS?
CSS.
So it's a dot.
Dot.
Yes. So you'll see that, do you have the CSS tab open? So if you click on CSS, maybe that's why. Hey, Brian, can you show him just where the CSS tab is? So that is the end of the tutorial, which seems stupid simple, and it is, but the idea is you're going to be using a lot of this to style your homework. Are there any?
The rect is defined here.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So that's an ID. BRCA is an ID.
Anyone running into any problems?
Okay, hash BRCA is an ID and dot.
No?
Dot.
Okay. So anyway, so that's pretty much it. The idea of keeping in mind to use these CSS things to style your elements is very important because, as Alex mentioned, you can do an inline style, which means that you're in your HTML and you write fill equals red and your circle's red, which is great for that one circle's red. And you want all of your circles to be red. So we want to use CSS a lot because A, you change it quickly, B, it applies to a lot of things. The only thing you need to do in the back is in your HTML, know that everything you want to style separately needs to go in the same class. And then obviously you can stack classes. Red, a class for everything that's red, a class for everything that's big or small or so forth. So this is just our first use of it, but it becomes very useful in the later homeworks. And that's pretty much the extent of what we're doing today. The homeworks going forward, we're probably going to be doing more homework-specific assignments, which this is pretty straightforward. Are there any questions? Things that that aren't clear.
Can you explain the part
where
you
said
can you explain the part where you said like you can apply the same colors to everything?
Oh, okay. So this is kind of it's the result of CSS selectors applying everything that had that class. And when I say everything, I mean everything that has that class. So you have a whole bunch of so one of the homeworks is the soccer homework, and we have all of the countries that won this the World Cup at some point. So we give them a class of dot winner. So I set class equals to winner if they won. So it's a JavaScript if else. Once I give them a dot winner, anybody with a dot winner is going to be colored in gold because my CSS says the dot winner colored in gold.
Okay. Do we, so we have to separate the CSS file or do we put in the header?
Oh, there's definitely, yeah. No, the header is like, if it's small enough, you don't want a separate file. For the most part, you have a dot CSS file.
So for the assignment, do you want us to do a separate CSS file? Or?
No, in the header is fine. It's just not enough for.
By default.
Anything else?
The file that will be used for HTML extension, right?
Yes.
That's
in this case,
it's a
yes,
file.
Yes, just like if you look at the. Do we have a. Just keep the. It's a style, right? It's the style.
Yes.
Whatever. It's called. Forgot. It's called. Tag. It's a style tag. You put your CSS at the top of the HTML. It's very much the. Not wanting to have a file bloat. But believe me, at homework three, you guys are going to have a separate CSS, JS, and HTML. That's like the ultimate combination of front end development files. Your styles, your code, your JavaScript code, and your HTML. And the better you get with JavaScript, the smaller your HTML gets, because you just have your very basic containers, body, side panel, whatever, and then your JavaScript does the magic of grabbing that and putting in SVGs and your CSS styles in. So as this grows, we'll definitely separate our concerns. But for now, it's just one file. No, that's okay.
What's the inline style?
Well, I'm sorry, I didn't understand that. Also, inline style is what we were saying before. You can, in your HTML, when you create your SVG, you say SVG, width equals 400, height equals 400, color, or fill equals red. If you do that, what your style, fill equals red. You have to put style so that it knows that you're styling it. So you're doing it in line with the definition of the SVG. This is different than defining your style in another file or just in the top of the HTML file and referencing it with a class. So you can use inline styles, especially when it's this small of a project, then it's perfectly fine and correct.
But that's the same thing, you should not use inline style.
I'm sorry. It's the homework, and I don't remember, I wrote this on summer vacation. This is not the reason. So if we're not, the reason that I probably said, I mean as an extension of Alex, said not to use inline styles is because it's not good practice as soon as your project goes beyond three rectangles, right? Mm-hmm. It's because you make it, then you have to go back into that file to fix it, and you want to separate concerns out. Unless anyone here codes in React, in which case we're a big fan of inline styling. But so first it would work. But as far as best practices, separate it out into a different, and it doesn't have to be a different file, but a different component, right? Like we're saying in the header, all of your styles are put together.
Okay.
HTML separate, JavaScript is separate.
So homework one, we can, we should, because it's a one file. So we should use AI.
Does it say sure should, whatever it says out there?
It says should not, but I think it says should.
No, so I think that what you're confusing here is when I say inline, it does not mean that it's necessarily in the same file. So we have our, at some point, you start your SVG and your width, your height. There is the option to write style equals, and then fill, and I don't know, sorry, from fill red. This is what we call inline style. It's where you're putting it in the same line where you define the SVG. This is not what we want you to do. What we do want you to do is have a style section here, and here you're doing is you're defining classes and ID selectors, right? And here is where you're putting fill. Right. It is in the same file, it's not the same line. And eventually we're going to just copy, cut this out, put this in a CSS file, and then include it with the script tag. So this is just the baby step before completely separating it out. This is obviously much harder to separate, because if every SVG of yours has a different style, The moment you decide you no longer want red, you want pink, you're changing in every single lesson, which is not good. Anything else?
Okay. How do you learn the not for colors and just for the data? Because I want to.
You mean the transforms? When you say the data, you mean?
Data, I want to give the data variable names in the CSS code at the very top. So I can reuse it if they don't have that here. So I don't have to.
You're using a variable name, you're using JavaScript.
That's confusing.
Variable in that is CSS.
Oh,
a
CSS?
Yeah, so I have to do inline style. Get the variable name.
That's fine. But you're not, because you're not setting the style, you're just linking it back to this.
Yeah.
Right? It's the equivalent of us setting
the style.
That's okay. That's perfectly fine. Yeah. And it's just a different way, like you're saying that if we had a dot, a class here, this is linking back to this. You're using a variable to link back to this. You're not putting red here.
Yes.
Yes. Any last takers? Yes.
So essentially, we form the elements using this enable and started using the CSS.
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
So when you turn it in, we're just getting as a file with HTML going through campus.
Yes. These are the moments where you really want to not hand it in late. It's a waste of points. As they get harder, you understand we might need an extra time or two. A lot of people, these are the grades that are going to really just help you in the end of having two or three homeworks where you got 100. And like I said, the people lose points in such stupid things like they'll do two lines instead of a line and a half. You can, if you can do a line, you can do a path. It's really just about reading the directions. So yeah, this is a no-brainer for starters. Okay. Well, thanks guys for coming out. I'll see you guys next week. Same time, same location. Yeah, see you guys in the future.